getting ready to have a tour of the mill here at Squire Boone Cavern.
Okay, if you, she's going to show you a little bit about the water up there. I want you to see that. That's the water that's coming out of the cave right here. And when you go through the cave, that is where that water comes out at. And it's gravity flow water, and that is the entrance to the cave that Squire found in 1790 when he came here. And so the whole idea of this is to understand how Squire was able to harness the energy from the water and power this wheel. So we'll go inside and I'll show you how it operates. Okay, so you've got gravity flow water. I'm going to make a couple of analogies for you. This wheel is kind of like an 1800s plug-in. It's really not doing anything until you plug something up to it. And it's all it is providing energy. And the weight of the water hitting those buckets is actually what's making the wheel turn. And all it is falling water. It's a lot like a bicycle. It's got a shaft in the middle of that wheel that comes under your feet in the basement. And it's wrapped to a system of pulleys and cogs. It turns just like a sprocket and chain on a bicycle. The best part about it is that you don't have to pedal it. The water does that. So that's how the energy from the water is harnessed. So this is kind of like a gas and clutch. This is going to lift the gate up in the trough. It's going to put more water on the wheel so that it'll turn faster because I need more energy. And the faster that it's turning, the more energy I have. Stones are really heavy, takes a lot of energy to turn them. So now I'm going to engage those parts underneath the feet. Backing up to the door over here and loading wagons full. So people offloading, people unloading. It's been a very big operation, not just one handful at a time. So that's pretty much about the grist mill, how it operates. The stones here came from France about 1760. They're French burr stones. And what they were balances, counterbalances on ships. And when the pioneers would go along the beaches, they would find these stones along the beach because they were thrown out in order to sell back to Europe. And they knew what to do with them. They put lines in stone like this one has, like this guy's doing. Well, just like the lines in this, different line depths for different grains. If you wanted to grind wheat, you'd have to get a wheat stone. So. These stones here are something that were carved by Squire Boone. They were in the original foundation of the mill. He was quite an artist, among other things. I'm sure you'll hear more about him in the cave when you get in the cave. I'll give you a quick rundown. He was a blacksmith, silversmith, gunsmith, carpenter, farmer, preacher, rock carver, land surveyor, Revolutionary War soldier who'd been shot 8 times. He suffered quite a bit in the Revolutionary War and for the founding of the country. And so it's pretty interesting to have something this old that was inscribed by his own hand. So there's that.
That's amazing. Thank you to David for this part of our tour.
Thank you.
Have you ever wondered how to make a candle? We're getting ready to find out. Come on.
With the candle tree, I can do 200 at a time, or I can do up to 600 a day. These are the paddles. It is holding the wick of the candle, and at the bottom is the little hooks. We put them on there for weight. So when I dip them, they don't float. It just holds them down. In order for me to make this large one, I'm going to have to dip it 30 times in this wax. So what I would do is I'm going to take it down like this. And then I bring it right back up. Every time I do that, it is going to pick up a layer of wax about the thickness of your nails. So then I'm gonna dip it 27 times. I will stop, measure the candle, and cut the hooks off. Clean the hooks up and reuse them. But then I'm gonna dip 3 more times. Now when I do that, it gives you the little drip on the bottom. And that little drip just means it's homemade and not store-bought. So if you ever go anywhere, you see that little drip, it's been handmade. All the candles behind you, there, ladies, is that I make and sell all over the world.
Mr. Billy Goat. How are ya?
Hi. So up here in the barnyard, we have what we call pen one, and it is shared by 3 animals. We have a white goat, Otis, a black goat, Jenny, and a mini pig named Reynolds. And Reynolds is kind of a big ham, no pun intended. Part of the hillside. This is a big tunnel that's man-made and been covered over. One of the easiest ways to find a cave is in the winter time when it's cold. You know how when you breathe out and you create steam with your breath because it's hot, it's cold outside. The cave stays 54 degrees year round. When it's really, really cold outside, warm air rises. So if it's 0 outside and 54 inside, hot air comes up. So that steam will shoot out of a hole. So they were walking the property one day and saw steam coming out of this area, and they're like, an entrance to the cave. So September 2016, this finished up and became the new entrance to the cave. So the first third of the cave tour will be new to you guys if you haven't been here since this. And it's beautiful. It's probably some of the most ornate parts of our cave. But this is a big long hallway. It echoes, so when we go in there, don't be disturbed by how it sounds when you walk through. When we go into the second door, we're literally stepping into the cave, into the side of the hill. It's pretty neat. So as you can see, we have some artwork here on the door that represents some of our formations in the cave. We have some stalactites that grow at the top of the ceiling. We have stalagmites that grow on the floor of the cave. And then we have a wing here in the middle that represents our bats. We do have several kinds of bats in this area. They're all tiny, small bats. Their body about like that, and their wingspan's about like that. We have the large brown, we have the small brown, the tri-tip, the gray, and the Indiana bat. And what's interesting about the Indiana bat is I think there's more in Ohio than there is in Indiana. But nonetheless, we have them here. And they do hibernate, all the bats in this area. It's too cold for them to stay out during the entire season. So they hibernate, which means they come into the cave and they take a little nap over the winter. And then when it gets warm, they go back out. The bats in our area are bug eaters, and I'm telling you, they eat some bugs. I'm grateful for them because every time, you know, I get stung, I think I need to get a bat box up because they would be eating that. Our agriculture too, they're great for our agriculture to keep bugs from eating our food. And there are about 1,500 kinds of bats around the world. The largest bat has a wingspan of about 6 to 7 feet wide. They're called flying foxes. Now, if you were to take away all their body and you just look at their head, it's like a little puppy dog. They're fuzzy, they got little brown eyes, they're so cute. And then there's 3 feet of this. I would still probably be a little nervous coming into meeting one, but they're fruit eaters, you know, they don't harm you like that. So don't be afraid of them, but they're big, you know. I'm 5'5", so their wingspan's even longer than my, you know, my span, maybe with this, but those are huge. And then you've got the bumblebee bat. It's real tiny, lives in Thailand, weighs about the size of a penny. So you've got this versus this, and then 1,500 in between. So they're all over the place. Bats are called a keystone species. Without bats, we don't live. I mean, it's that simple. We've got to have them to live. So if you're ever interested in studying about bats and learning about them and keeping them alive, that would be awesome. And
I saw their pollinators. Are all of them pollinators or just some of them?
Not all are pollinators. Everybody has a different function. Like some, they're born and bred to poop. They go out, they eat stuff, and in certain areas of the country, you can see where they fly and they poop, and then whatever they poop, that grows. So they actually just help things to grow. Some are pollinators, some are poopers, some are bug eaters, some are fruit eaters, you know, that kind of thing. So everybody has a certain function in their life.
And it's almost Halloween. Are there any vampire bats around here?
You know, there's kind of a misnomer about vampire bats. They don't come up and, you know, or anything like that. There are some bats around the world that do like to lick blood. And what they do is they have this little sharp claw, and they will fly down onto the ankle of like a cow or a goat or something, and they'll nick it, and they'll just lick a few little drops. And what's in their blood or in their saliva will, when they lick, will help coagulate that. And there's actually medical studies about bat saliva and how we can use that for us to help coagulate our blood when we're bleeding. So there's a lot of study about that, but you're not going to see anything come up and just
sort of closes the wound, yeah, so they don't bleed to death.
Right, so they're actually very beneficial, and they're not scary, and they're not very big bats either, so.